mention further a couple of things we'd like to do in regards to the 70th anniversary, and that's just to recognize some individuals and some families that have been here for a long, long time. And to begin with, there's a little PowerPoint thing. You're going to see some pictures of families. And these are not current pictures. They go back a few years, and so you don't have to be well-mannered and raise your hand and wait till you're called on if you recognize who the family is. Do we have a name for this family? Okay, Rogers, and what's the name of the kids? Rex and Rhonda. Great. Picture number two. What do you think of Ernie's haircut there, buddy? Does anybody know who this is? That would be the Mallonies, and we need somebody to name them all.
Chris?
That was a little bit weak, but I can't give corrections, so I'm going to assume that that was accurate. That's the Mallonies.
Oh,
Ted Buddy Nichols. Carol, I know it's scary. I don't know. Your picture comes up with a bunch of oldies, but
you woke me up.
You're not allowed to answer.
Do we have names for all those people? First name. Brian, Teresa, Lloyd, and Carol.
I'm the quiet one.
Gables, Maurice, Charlotte, and the two kids? Mark and Nancy.
Herman.
When's the last time you saw Ted looking like that?
A long time ago.
Kim, you did not expect to see yourself there today.
Warren Davis, yeah.
That would be the Davises. And little Danny.
Durst.
Wayne, Evelyn, and the kids. Dave, Debbie, and
Tim.
Okay. Is that it?
That was it.
Okay, thank you, Chris. We'd like to take a moment to recognize charter members. And when you're going back 70 years, the number is very limited. And back 70 years ago, there were 60 individuals that made up the charter membership of Calvary Baptist Church. And four of them are here today. And if you would just stand when your name is called, and that would be Yvonne Rogers, Joanne Furman, Marlene Furman, and Marceline Lanning. In addition to that, now this might be a challenge as far as hopefully you won't stand longer than you can handle, but we'd like to recognize long-term members, because there's a lot of you that say, man, I wasn't a charter member, but I go almost all the way back to the beginning. If you've been a member for more than 40 years, would you stand your feet?
Thank you. Thank you.
Sometimes in the course of meeting together, I hear comments from some of our newer folks saying, well, I never heard how this church started or what the roots are. And I would like to just address that real briefly, and I'll read just the first portion of what Yvonne Rogers put together several years back, Memories of Calvary. But it just rehearses for you the earliest days of Calvary Baptist Church. Reads like this: in the spring of the year of 1946, Calvary Baptist Church began due to apostasy and modernism in the former Northern Baptist Convention. At that time, many churches in the convention were faced with Bible-denying liberals and unbelief. Apostate pastors and missionaries were being sent to the churches, bringing modernism, which caused great stress. This was not just a local problem, and as a result, fundamentalists in the convention had to take a stand against the rising tide of unbelief. Our local church voted to remain in the Northern Baptist Convention. And after much prayer and consideration, a group of 35 people met in the home of Mr. and Mrs. Frank Farrar for Bible study and prayer, continuing to seek God's will. It was then realized the time had come, we must separate ourselves from the convention, claiming the scripture 2 Corinthians, it doesn't say the chapter, I think it's chapter 7, I believe, 6 or 7. The decision was made, verses 14 to 18. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? For what communion hath light with darkness? Or what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. And I will receive you, and will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters, my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. It was realized Christ must have preeminence. These decisions were not easy. It was very difficult leaving the friends and church which we had loved so long. However, there was much love among the brethren, and this brought strength and joy to our hearts. Bound together in Christian love, many prayed. Great blessings came to our group as many new decisions were made, and soon it was necessary to find a church building. At that time, the Lutheran church on Main Avenue had discontinued services. The group asked to rent the church, and permission was given, and it was there the charter was written and the church organized. The charter was closed the last Sunday in August 1946. Membership was then 60. The church then became associated with Ohio Independent Baptist, which became what is today the Ohio Association of Regular Baptist Churches. Homer Pimlet, an outstanding Bible teacher, taught the scripture until our first pastor was called. In addition to that, I thought it would be very appropriate if we might review our membership covenant. This is really what bound us together, what beliefs, what convictions, 70 years ago, and it's these core commitments and beliefs that do today. And so I'd like to read those for you. Having been led by the Spirit of God to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we do now in the presence of God most earnestly and joyfully enter into covenant with one another as one body in Christ. We purpose to walk together in Christian love and to strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort. We commit ourselves to promote its prosperity and spirituality and to sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines. We will also contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel to all nations. We also purpose to maintain family and private devotions, to biblically educate our children, and to seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances. We further purpose to walk uprightly in the world, to be just in our dealings, faithful in our engagements, and exemplary in our conduct, to avoid all tattling, backbiting, and excessive anger, to abstain from any practice which would bring unwarranted harm to our body, mind, or testimony, and to be zealous in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Savior. We purpose to watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember each other in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy in feeling and courtesy in speech, to be slow to take offense, to be ready for reconciliation, and to secure it without delay. We moreover purpose that when we remove from this place, we will as soon as possible unite with another church where we can resume the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's word.
Pastor Dennis asked me to talk about the impact the Calvary Baptist has had on my life. I was raised in a family where family is important, and I've come to realize that my church family is also important in my life. When I think about my family and my church family, I think memories. I think cherished memories and supporting each other through the good times and the bad. My first memories for me for Calvary Baptist was when we first started attending this church. Julie was in kindergarten and Justin was in second grade. My memories of that time in the church, lots of children, Awana games, the Sparky Crawl, Justin's first Bible competition. We attended Sunday school and our children participated in junior church. Our children were provided a Christian foundation throughout all these children's ministries. Harold and I developed close friendships with other Christian couples in the church. Julie sang in the Sunshine Quintet. Mm-hmm. Judy Furman bought the girls matching outfits.
Yeah.
Such memories and how the church was impacting our family. Our family served Calvary in choir, Awana, children's ministries, and Sunday school teachers. As our children grew, they eventually became part of the youth group. They attended Christian camps, TLC at Baptist Bible College. They participated in mission trips to Portugal and Louisiana. During Julie's high school years, that's when Julie felt God calling her into full-time ministry. The year the team went to Portugal, the whole faith of the church grew because through prayer we realized that God could financially send our whole team to Portugal without any fundraisers, and they all raised their own support. Our children invited other teens and friends to church. Sammy Ames and Tyler Cota were saved because of being invited to our church. This church has had such an impact in its 70 years on children and teens who would eventually go into full-time ministry. Names like Rex Rogers, Nancy Ables, Ted Nichols, Ken Nichols, Kenny Kirby, Julie Bump, and the list could go on. I love how Calvary ministers to the entire family. We have a variety of small groups based on different family situations and needs. We have women's Bible studies that study and pray together on a regular basis. We go to outreach with the community, with Vacation Bible School, Awana, and movies such as Fireproof. Happy anniversary, Calvary Baptist Church. My family and I look forward to the next 70 years.
I came to Calvary in the eighth grade, but didn't really get serious about attending church until the Lord made an impact on my life at the age of 16. At 16, I got saved at a youth night that we used to have on Sunday evenings, and I was baptized that July. Had I known then what I know now, I would have been in church regularly from the eighth grade on, and even sooner, to be honest. I came here having never been in church except for a few times for a wedding or just tagging along with someone. But normally when those events came up, I just sat and colored and didn't really pay attention to what was being said by the pastor. I thought it was a good enough thing just to be there. For all those years, I truly missed out on what church was really about, the worship of Jesus Christ and building a relationship with him that is always growing stronger. Fast forward to 2016. Here we are to celebrate 70 years of this wonderful church that has touched the lives of so many people. I've been a member of Calvary for 11 years now, and can honestly say that because of my time here, I'm not the same person that I was, who begrudgingly walked in just to shut up all of my nagging friends. I'm thankful that they nagged me. I can also honestly say that I've never seen another church quite like ours. Never one so serious about proclaiming God's word faithfully, sharing the gospel boldly, praying persistently, worshiping Jesus passionately, and loving one another sacrificially. We're so blessed and fortunate to have been led by God's many pastors and have never forsaken what God's word tells us. They have always humbly led their flocks. In some ways, I have become a different person just by being here and because of the love that I've been shown. But truthfully, I have become who I am today because I've seen the Lord work in awesome ways through this body of believers. Had the Lord never brought me to Calvary, I doubt that I would have had many of the opportunities that I've had or created as many lasting relationships as I have. Because of the Lord working through this church, I've been so blessed in many ways. I've been fortunate to be part of Team 6, the men's discipleship group, for most of my time that's been here. It originally started as a group of guys reading good theology books and enjoying breakfast at McDonald's before high school, and it's now turned into a group with the purpose of learning theology to pass it on to others, as we're told to do in 2 Timothy 2:2, while being accountable to, praying for, and encouraging our brothers in Christ. I've had the opportunity to serve in many music ministries while I've been here, like worship team, choir, EM band, and a few others. And anybody who knows me knows that music has never really been my strong suit, but something that I've enjoyed as a member of Calvary. And my love of music has caused many times of worship to be very sweet. There have been so many great songs that I've learned that have gotten me through some of the toughest times and have allowed me to praise the Lord in many of the best times. I've also built many lasting relationships that wouldn't be possible outside of this body of believers. Your church family just understands you in a way that those in the world do not, and I'm so grateful for those relationships that I've made that I know will be eternal. A huge impact that this church has made on me is that it has caused me to really understand the go part of our No Grow Go slogan. Our church truly takes the gospel to the world, whether directly or indirectly. We support so many missionaries in places that sometimes I've not even heard of, as well as in our community. I've had the chance to go on 3 mission trips in my time here, twice to Cider Hills Christian Camp, where I also worked for a summer, and to work on service projects around the camp and as a worship team, and also to Slidell, Louisiana, after Hurricane Katrina hit. These trips have taught me that there is a world outside of our neighborhoods that need to know and love and see the love of Jesus, and those trips completely changed me and gave me a stronger burden for the lost. Our intercessors prayer group on Saturdays has also reminded me to pray for others that do not yet have a relationship with Jesus, which helps to take the focus off of my selfish wants and desires and moves it to people who desperately need the Lord and need our prayers. Lastly, this church has touched me and helped me grow in very personal ways. When my dad had a very bad stroke last year, the calls, prayers, encouragement, food, and love really helped us through. I was so moved when Mom's WOW group even came over to my house to help me clean it from top to bottom to prepare for Mom and Dad to come home from the hospital. This was a truly beautiful testimony of our church, and I could see the ladies being the hands and feet of Jesus. When we lost my Aunt Vicki a year ago, the dinner that we had was all ready for us when we got here, which eased our minds and allowed us to spend time with family and friends. Pastor Dennis was such an encouragement to her in her last days as she quickly flourished as a new believer. This church has also put me to teach not only a small group, Sunday school, vacation Bible school, or discipleship groups, but it's also made me realize that education was what I wanted to pursue as my career so that I could touch the lives of others with the love of Christ. I don't think it is a coincidence that I just secured my dream job of 7th grade social studies right before this big celebration. The Lord's timing is everything. I would never have experienced the spiritual growth that I've experienced if I had not come to Calvary and learned through through the Word what it means to be sensitive to the drawing of the Holy Spirit. I could never say enough about what all of you mean to me and how grateful I am for what Jesus has done in my life through all of you and through His Word.
Good Lord could have taken me then. When I was smart, 17 or 18 years old. I thought I'd see how fast an automobile would go. Well, believe me, a Camaro can go fast. And I decided, well, wonder how it would act if it was on its roof. I lost control, and the roof of the car went down below the steering wheel.
Oh.
I still have pictures of it. I didn't have a seatbelt on. Good Lord wanted me here. In 1967, I went into Marine Corps. And believe me, during boot camp, I'd asked the good Lord to take me out of here. It was a rough time. It was some very rough. But he let me know, less than a year later, I was in Vietnam. 1968 wasn't a pretty year. The good Lord brought me here. All the things in my life have had an effect on me growing up. And I'm sure there's times that my wife can tell you she'd like to send me home too. But we've had a good marriage, and the good Lord has brought me here. We moved from Toledo to this area, and we searched for a while for a church, and I think it was kind of half-heartedly. And then our grandsons come to live with us, and Calvary had the reputation that they had a good youth group. We brought our grandchildren here. Well, they've since come and gone. Our youth group has gotten maybe a little smaller, but it's growing. But the good Lord says, you stay here. And it's because of each and every single one of you out there that I greet on Sunday morning. It has been an inspiration to Rhonda and I that this church loves God and is truly Jesus Christ is here. And I don't want to be anywhere else. And I told Harold Moore, I'll take that cleaning job if you guarantee me I'll be here until I'm 90. And he's still.
Yeah.
He still watches us, I'm sure. We miss him a lot. And I just want to thank each and every one of you guys, especially Pastor and Jan, for being so wonderful to us as our family. And you're all closer to me than my brothers and sisters. And I just love every single one of us.
God's word by godly teachers. Christian teachers and have followed our Lord faithfully. The longer I live, the more I thankful I am for those who did serve faithfully, and for pastors who have taught the Word of God, been faithful to the Word of God, for Pastor Ross remaining with the Word of God, and for Joe Kine for that wonderful, encouraging message this morning to continue on. Our desire is to remain faithful to our wonderful Lord for the next generation. All glory to God. That will be only glory by and by.
Really great, because I'm focusing on those first two verses of Hebrews 12, And Hebrews 11 just really kind of gives the backdrop information, and it's amazing the way the Lord works. And then he kept going, and he got into chapter 12, and uh-oh. I know sometimes when in music, and you plan a program, and somebody's doing special music, and it turns out you sang that song in congregational singing, and it's like, oh no, you know, now what do I do? And I thought, well, this is interesting, because I didn't intend to have a long message or anything, but I did want to share some things from Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. And I do believe that our God is sovereign and that he's well able to lead Joe to Hebrews 11 and 12 and me to Hebrews 12. And if that's the case, I would say God really wants us to see some things from Hebrews 11 and 12 today. But again, just this time will be very brief, so please give me your fullest attention. Those first two verses of chapter 12. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. I really wanted to just emphasize two or three things in there that to just impress upon us. One of them is that issue of so great a cloud of witnesses. And I don't believe, from my study, the cloud of witnesses. Sometimes growing up, I had the image that, you know, we're here functioning on earth, and up in heaven, there's this big clump of people. And you know, there's Abraham and Moses and David and Samson and all of them, and they're all together, and it's sort of like, you know, at the football game of the universe. And here we're the players, and sometimes I go, yay, and other times I go, boo, you know, and it's like whether we do good or whether we don't do good, they boo or cheer. The idea in that word witnesses is the idea of the word testify. All those Old Testament heroes are ones who, by their lives, by their exploits, which they were enabled by God to do, through their faith, they are testifiers that it is possible to live a godly, God-honoring, victorious life, no matter what the circumstances. Each of those came from some kind of setting where it was a very ungodly setting. Difficult challenges of life. And God says, since we are here with such a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us, they're not cheerleaders. They're people who have gone before us, and they testify. No matter what your life situation is, no matter who your parents are, no matter whether you're rich or poor, it is possible to live a victorious Christian life. It's possible to live a life that honors and glorifies God. It can be done. They testify that it can be done. The emphasis is with each one. It can be done through faith. It's by faith Moses did what he did. By faith, Abraham and Sarah did what they did. By faith, Samson did the good things that he accomplished. And every one of them, it says, by faith they did those things. And it's not faith in faith. It's faith in God and his revealed word. That God is our creator. He is the sustainer of life. He's the eternal judge. And that Jesus, his son, is the savior. And that this book is his revealed word, and it's valid, it's true, it's relevant for all times. And the essence of, by faith, basically, they went against the flow of the world in which they lived. And they said, regardless of what other people live and what they do, I believe Jehovah God is the true God. I will seek for him. I will seek him in my life. I'll honor him and just trust that somehow God will work for good. And it's the same challenge that I face and the same challenge that every one of you face. To live a life of faith in a world that doesn't understand faith. To live a life of faith that says, I believe God's word is still true, it's still relevant. Everything God teaches about eternal life and resurrection life and the means of salvation and how to build a marriage and how to handle your sexuality and your thought life and how to raise a family, everything in there is still good and true and relevant. And so the message in those first two verses is really this. Being mindful that many before you have lived and served well. You endure, you endeavor to do the same thing. Go out. Your challenges are different. The challenges for kids today who are 20 years old, way different than some of you who 20 years old was 60 or 70 years ago. It's an entirely different world. It's an entirely different world than it was for me at 20 years old. But the message is, God's word is true. It's still our guidebook. Jesus is still the only Savior. There's still an eternal heaven. There's still an eternal hell. Being mindful that many before you have lived and served well. Old Testament saints, but as we've even seen here today, throughout the ages, God always has heroes of the faith. Ones who have walked well, lived well, said no to sin and basically yes to God and His purposes. And the call for me and the call for you is endeavor to do the same thing. Let go of every sin that would hinder you, it would disqualify you. And then the message is all the while looking unto Jesus. It's not looking unto the Old Testament saints and say, I got to get their approval. Or even looking unto Yvonne Rogers or any of the ones who have been here for 70 years or 60 years. It's looking unto Jesus. We have ones who have gone before us that testify by their lives and their words. No matter what your life situation is, it is possible to live for the glory of God and do great things for Him. But in the process, don't look to me, don't look to them, look unto Jesus. Jesus is the perfect example. Every pastor you've ever had will fail you. Everyone who ever sings for special music or stands up for some reason or does something, at some point, they'll disappoint you, they'll fail you. Jesus is the perfect example. And so the scripture says, well, in you living out your life, look unto Him. He's the goal, He's the prize, He's the example. He is the worthy one. He's the only one worth living for. He's the only one worth dying for. He's the one that's worthy of our best. And so the scripture says, as you live out your life and you seek to make a difference with your life, look to Him. Let's pray. Lord God, we do thank You for the day that we've had. Thank You for Your blessings. Thank You for ones who've worked hard to get together and prepare music. For ones who've shared testimony and just remembrances of what You've done in their lives. We've done these things to glorify You. We've done them to be an encouragement to each other. And so I pray that as we go our ways and we look to the future, that You would help us to be people who are strong, who are focused, who walk by faith and seek Your glory and Your purpose. And I pray that You would visit us, that You would look upon us, because we are needy. We can't make anything good happen. We're dependent upon You and upon the work of the Holy Spirit. As Paul says, we can plant or we can water, but only God can give the increase. Help us to be faithful to do all that we can do, to proclaim Your word to unbelievers, to worship, to encourage each other in our faith. And I pray that we would see Your blessing, and that every time we meet and every day as we go our separate ways, we'd be mindful of the work of the Spirit of God among us, and that we would see your glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Well, didn't you realize we were going to close with that? Because that's my highlight.
Starting their careers, and this church has been our home ever since. So this is in memory of Susan. Children singing.
reminder, if you're able-bodied, your help would be appreciated to just put the tables and chairs away in the fellowship hall. And I apologize to Diane. I guess I was just so anxious to get into the scriptures, I overlooked, I was wanting to put it together, so I don't have any excuse, but sorry, Diane. Anyway, thank you for being here and just your participation today. It's been a good day. Thank you for being here. Gary, would you dismiss us in prayer?
Dear Lord, as we conclude today's services, Lord, we just want to, first and foremost, continue to honor and to glorify you through Christ. We thank you, Lord, for this celebration day, 7 years of Calvary Baptist here in Byesville. Thank you, Lord, in a special way for all that those brought forth, special music, presentations, their testimonies, our meal and preparation. Continue to guide, direct us, Lord, for the next 7 years. We promise to give you all the praise and the glory. Thank you.